Well, thank you very much, Victor. So, good morning, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here. So, as Victor said, I'm going to talk about the formal verification of compilers and related tools. And so let me start with some general discussion about compilers and how much trust you can put in them and how much trust you need to put in them. So you're all familiar with compilers. So in general, it's any automatic translation from a computer language to another. And it has a more restrictive meaning, which is the efficient, so-called optimizing translation from a source language that humans can write and understand towards some machine code or even circuits that can be executed efficiently in hardware. So that's one of the oldest areas of computer science. So the first optimizing compiler was Fortran 1 in 57, and it was already pretty advanced for the time because it had to be competitive with handwritten assembly code. And since then, well, there have been a huge corpus of code generation of optimization algorithms and also many industrial strength compilers, both commercial and open source. GCC and LLVM are both excellent examples, and they both received awards from ACMSIC plan recently. And so many industrial strength compilers that really perform subtle transformations in the programs you give them. So that might not be completely obvious to everyone, so let me show you the results of a little experiment I did a while ago. So I took a simple C function, so this one computes the dot product of two vectors of floating point numbers of size n. So this is kind of the textbook formula for dot product, right? And then I compiled this with a good optimizing compiler and looked at the generated assembly code. And it was huge and I couldn't make any sense out of it. So I spent some more time manually decompiling it back to C. Maybe that would be more readable. And I got this, which you can't really see, but it's huge. And it still doesn't make much sense. And after staring at it for a while, you notice something that looks like a loop. Okay, L17, go to L17. And then you start to realize that the compiler chose to unroll the original loop by a factor of 4. So in this loop, you have 4 multiplications, 4 additions, and 8 memory loads. And then the compiler applied a technique known as software pipelining, whereas at each iteration of this loop, the four additions for the current iteration are computed, then the 4 multiplications for the next iterations are computed in advance, then the loads for the n plus 2 iteration of the loop are performed. And that gives more time for the hardware and the cache and the memory to produce the results, and increases instruction level parallelism. Then there are also some more memory optimizations here based on prefetching. And what does the rest of the code do? Well, it's all special cases because those software pipelines, the first iteration is special. It primes the pipeline. The last iteration is special. It drains the pipeline. Then the pipeline is not applicable if the number of iterations is too small, in which case there's also a copy of the original loop here that will do the computation one by one. And finally, remember, we unrolled by a factor of 4, so if the number n is not a multiple of 4, we also need to do some compensation code. So in the end, we get code that is much faster than what you could write naively by hand, maybe a factor of 2 or 3 on an in-order processor. But it's really not obvious that this is still computing dot product. So you may say, okay, that's a crazy optimization. I took one of the most advanced optimizations that you can find in textbooks, which is true. But I would also like to point out that even unoptimized code generation is sometimes delicate because you have to work around limitations of the hardware. And for instance, in the C language, in many languages, you need to convert from integers to floating point. And it so happened that in the PowerPC 32-bit architecture, there is no instruction to do that in hardware. But the user's manual for the processor suggests that, well, you should implement it this way. So basically, well, this is C code, but actually the compiler will generate assembly code corresponding to that. So it manufactures two 64-bit integers, with this magic number in the high 32 bits, the integer in question in the low 32 bits for this one, zero for that one. Then it converts those two to floating point, just seeing them as, viewing them as double precision floating point numbers and as a floating point subtraction. Aha. So why does it work? Well, it works because this 64-bit integer, a magic number times 2 to the 32 plus x, is the bit-level encoding of the double floating point number 2 to the 52 plus x, the integer x viewed as a double. And so if you subtract, the subtraction here cancels out the 2 to the 52 factors, and it is exact. There is no rounding. So in the end, you get the correct result, but really for non-obvious reasons, okay? All right, and so inevitably, there are bugs in compilers, just like in any other piece of software. And there are bugs called miscompilation, which is basically generating wrong code, machine code that computes, that doesn't compute what the source says it should be computed. So here are some documented evidence. In 95, Nullstone, which is a conformance test suite for C compilers, isolated defects in the way integer division is compiled in 12 of 20 commercially available compilers that they evaluated. So integer division, okay, pretty basic operation. All right, maybe that was 95, and maybe we've made some progress since, but well, not that much. So in 2008, ID and Reger at University of Utah developed a very nice framework for random testing of C compilers, by random generation of interesting pieces of C code and then differential testing between compilers. And they found for pretty much all the compilers they tested cases where the compilers generate incorrect code for accessing volatile variables. So their first test was just about volatile variables, and an important aspect for system software. So, well, they said it's a bit of a concern because, well, system software is important, right? Then they generalized their testing methodology to pretty much all of the C language 3 years later, and again found lots of miscompilation bugs in every compiler that they tested. And then, well, it became a cottage industry to do random testing of compilers, and so another team in Japan found, for instance, that this little piece of code, which is just computing constants, all right, is miscompiled by all versions of GCC from 3.1 to 4.7.2, so about 15 years of GCC. All right, so is this a real problem? Are those miscompilation bugs a real problem? Well, for non-critical software, maybe not that much. I mean, programmers rarely run into them, although when they do, it's very hard to debug. In general, the compiler is the last thing you suspect. But globally, bugs introduced by the compilers are negligible compared with the bugs already present in the source code, okay? But that's not the case for critical software. I mean, critical in the sense of life critical. Think of fly-by-wire systems for airplanes. Think of medical equipment like pacemakers. Think of control of nuclear plants, that kind of things. So for critical software, miscompilation is actually a source of concern, and it requires additional verification activities. Maybe more testing, maybe manual reviews of generated assembly code. Well, every manufacturer of critical software has their own recipes to try to keep miscompilation under control. So it complicates the qualification process. I mean, when you need to go through authorities, like the aircraft, the FAA in the US and get certification for your airplane software, you have to explain what you are doing to address this risk in particular. And miscompilation risk reduces the usefulness of formal verification. And that's what really makes me sad, because like all of you here, I'm a firm believer in formal methods. And the problem is that, well, there are many kinds of formal methods like model checking, deductive program proof, static analysis, and a few of them apply directly to the executable machine code as it runs in the machine. Well, there are some examples like the worst case execution time analyzers of the Absinthe company in Germany that works right at the machine level. But most other static analysis tools work, for instance, at the C code level, and likewise for deductive program proof, and for model checking, you can even work at the level of a model, like Simulink or SCADE model. And so the guarantees you get by using those tools may be invalidated by bugs in miscompilation bugs in the code generator that produces C from Simulink or SCADE, or by the compiler that produces executable from C. All right? And so we get guarantees on the source level, but we are not entirely sure that they really apply to what's actually running in the system. And that makes me sad. Okay, so we need to do something about that. And so the approach I've been working on for the last 8 years or so is a formal verification of compilers. So let's take, compilers are programs like any other, so we can apply formal verification to them, typically program proof. Maybe they are complicated programs, but they have a fairly simple spec, which is a so-called semantic preservation property. So if compilation succeeds without errors, the generated code should behave as prescribed by the semantics of your source program. And once you've proved that, you obtain as a corollary that any safety property of the observable behavior of the source program carries over to the generated executable code. And so this use of formal methods at formal verification at the source level becomes a lot more justified. All right? So I promised some profit and some fun in the title of the talk. So here is the profit part. I'm not sure this is monetary profit, but at least it's profit with respect to certification and qualification issues, like these DO 178 requirements for avionics or common criteria for security. So the hope is that a formally verified compiler that provides strong guarantees, that formal verification can provide strong guarantees on compilers and code generators, guarantees that would be hard to obtain by other means like testing or code reviews. And in particular, that may also enable the use of aggressive optimizations in the context of those critical software. So for instance, at Airbus, they have a methodology where that relies on traceability of the assembly code towards the source code. And they really need, for that methodology to work, they really need that the same piece of source code in any context will compile to approximately the same sequence of instructions, which prevents all optimizations, basically, okay? And then, of course, they run into performance issues. The software is too slow, blah, blah, blah. With a formally compiler, we can hope to benefit from aggressive optimizations or even maybe synthesis in the context of high assurance software. And finally, as I said, this should generate confidence in the results of source level formal verification, making it easier to derive certification credit from the use of those verification tools and not just from testing. All right, so that's the profit part. And the fun part is that, well, it's a real challenge. I mean, compilers are fascinating pieces of software. They use complex data structures like abstract syntax trees, control flow graphs, etc. Interesting algorithms, often recursive, often using fixed point iterations and that kind of things. And their specifications involve the formal operational semantics for big languages, your source language, your target assembly code, probably intermediate languages as well. So it's a real challenge, which, as of today, I believe is beyond the reach of automated verification techniques, but is a very good match for interactive theorem proving. So that's definitely not a new idea. That there are things to be proved about compilers. So it was the first occurrence of this idea, published occurrence of this idea goes back to 1967. I wasn't even born. So that's a famous paper by John McCarthy and James Painter on the correctness of a compiler for arithmetic expressions. So the simplest compiler we teach to students, you take arithmetic expressions and you generate code for a stack machine. And they said that, yes, well, it's interesting to write down the correctness, a correctness proof for this compilation. And they say that, it's all intended to serve as prototype for the more complicated task of proving the correctness of usable compilers. So back in 67, they already had this idea in mind. And only 4 years later, Robin Milner and Richard Dyrock mechanized the proof of McCarthy and Painter using one of the very first interactive proof assistants, Stanford LCF. And so again, they just do arithmetic expressions. But so mechanized in the sense the proof is fully checked by a tool, okay, by the LCF tool. And again, they say that more than half of the complete proof has been machine checked, so that's a part related to expressions. And then they also envisioned a bigger algol-like language, and they say we anticipate no difficulty with the remainder. Well, that was perhaps a little optimistic. Because it took a while to, I mean, there were a number of other formal verification of compiler projects in the 90s in particular. And now let me present you what I think is the state of the art in this area. So that is Comsort verified compiler that I've been working on for a while with several colleagues from INRIA and Rennes, in particular Sandrine Blasi and our students. So the goal of the project was to develop and prove correct a realistic compiler usable for critical embedded software. So by usable, we mean that the source language must be one that is used to program a critical embedded system, so not just arithmetic expressions, but actually a very large subset of C in all its ugliness. And likewise, we target real machines, so not just stacked machines, but actually the PowerPC, the ARM, and the x86. And we try to generate reasonably compact and fast code, so we have careful code generation, some optimizations, not that many yet. And one thing to note is that we are not trying to take an existing compiler like GCC and prove it correct a posteriori. Oh, that would probably be very hard. Well, first, GCC is huge. Several millions lines of code. And second, it wasn't written with the needs of a proof in mind. Okay, so what we do is actually we develop our own compiler from scratch and we do the proof, and sometimes the proof informs us that we should really write the compiler slightly differently. And so it's really software proof co-design, if you want. And so that's the formally verified part, the Comsort compiler. So we start with Comsort C, which is abstract syntax for our large subset of C99. And then we go through a number of intermediate languages in blue of progressively lower semantic level and end up with assembly language for our three target processors. And so every arrow in red is a compilation pass. So there's about, 12 or 15 passes total. Some of the passes basically translate away some high-level constructs into simpler constructs. And some other passes are optimizations that try to improve the quality of the generated code. So here, for instance, in this register transfer language, we have some classic optimizations like constant propagation, common sub-expression elimination, function inlining, etc. And a pretty good register allocator, which I will talk in more details in a second. All right, so viewed from a compiler viewpoint, this is completely standard technology from the late 80s, early 90s, okay, so nothing really surprising. But what is different with Comsort is that each of those languages, source, intermediate, target, have formal operational semantics. And each of those passes is proved to preserve those semantics. And so in the end, the composition of the passes, which is the whole compiler, also has this semantic preservation property. And so we are using a proof assistant to write the specifications and to conduct the proofs and to have them checked in the end. So we are using the Coq proof assistant. There's basically no way this work can be done just with proofs on paper. It would just be too big. And so, so the correctness proof is of semantic preservation is entirely machine checked. This is pretty much the final theorem in the development. So it's written in Coq syntax, just to show you that it's not too unreadable. So what does it say? Trans-C program is a function that represents the compiler, the composition of all passes. So it says that for any program P, which is a C program. If trans-C program applied to P doesn't fail on an error, compact time error, but says OK and returns a transform program TP, which is a piece of assembly code, then any behavior of TP according to the semantics of the ASM language, then for any behavior B of the TP ASM program, there exists a behavior of the source program P, according to the C semantics, that is either identical or improved, such that the behavior of the assembly code is either identical or improves on the behavior of the C program. So what is this business with behaviors? Let me try to explain that. So behaviors are what we observe about the source and compiled programs. That includes whether they terminate or diverge or crash on an undefined behavior, like division, integer division by zero, or dereferencing the null pointer, plus a trace of the I/O operations performed by the program. Typically, some functions are designated as system calls, so we trace their calls in the trace. And there are also accesses to global volatile memory, which can be hardware devices, all right? So we have that trace of I/O operation and an indication on how the program terminates. So that's what we observe. There are plenty of things we don't observe, like execution time, for instance, okay? And what the theorem says is that the behavior of the generated code is at least as good as one of the behaviors of the source program. So first of all, the source program may have several behaviors because of non-determinism in C, like the evaluation order is not completely specified, so a given program can have several behaviors, but the compiler is choosing one. And then if the source code has a good behavior, one that never invokes undefined behavior, we know that the compiled code will exhibit exactly that behavior. However, if the source code, after some input and output, invokes an undefined behavior, like integer division by zero, then the assembly code will do at least the same input and output, and then it can do whatever it wants. And why is that? Well, that's part of the C language. If your source program has undefined behavior, basically it can have all behaviors. And another way to think about this is that the compiler may have optimized away the undefined behavior. Maybe your source code had a division by zero, but the compiler said, okay, the program is not using the result of this division, so let me just eliminate the division, and then the undefined behavior goes away. So that the improved undefined behavior. But really, what we want is source code, what we expect is source code that is verified to be free of undefined behaviors, in which case we really get equality of behaviors, which is exactly semantic preservation, right? All right, so a few words about the proof effort, or just one word, it's big. It's about 1,000 lines of code. And among these 1,000 lines, there's about 15,000 lines that are the source code for the compiler. It basically expresses all the compiler algorithms. And so that's written in a fairly compact style of purely functional programming. So I estimate that would be about 60,000 lines of Java. So that's the code part here. Then there are formal semantics for all the language involved. That's a pretty big spec. Then there are statements of theorems and lemmas, many intermediate lemmas. Then there are proof scripts where we hold the hand of the Coq proof assistant so that to help it find the proofs, and some various directives and so on. So the whole effort is about 6 person years, and proof automation is pretty low. So Coq is not very good at automatic theorem proving, but still it has some facilities that I didn't fully exploit. All right, so we are using Coq for specification, we are using Coq for proving, and we are also using Coq for programming. So all the verified part of the compilers are programmed directly in Coq specification language in pure functional style. So Coq, the Coq spec language includes a small functional language, which is pure and terminating. So kind of the intersection of Haskell and Camel, if you want. So we don't have mutable data structures like hash tables and so on, but we can use purely functional data structures instead. And when we need to handle errors or things like this, we don't have exceptions, but there's a well-known monadic encoding of that into pure functional programming, which we use. And so from these function definitions written in Coq, there's an extraction mechanism, a code generator that produces executable camel code, okay? So why do we do this instead of writing the compiler in a normal programming language and then doing program proof in that language? Well, the beauty of this approach is that the functions are part of Coq's logic. So Coq knows how to reason about those functions, how to unroll recursive definitions, etc. So we don't need a separate program logic like Hoare logic to reason about the functions. We can directly talk about them in the statements of normal theorems, like here. Okay, this is a program, but this is also a mathematical function in the logic of Coq. All right, and so my claim is that, well, I think purely functional programming is the shortest path to writing and proving a program. I mean, if you're starting from scratch and you want in the end to have something that runs and is fully proved, do consider purely functional programming. All right, so just to be fully honest, not everything is proved in concert. So this is the formally verified part that we saw in a previous diagram, and that extracts to OCaml. And then there are still a bunch of code that is handwritten in OCaml and doesn't and is not fully proved. So there's a fairly convoluted path from the C source text file to this abstract syntax tree that involves pre-processing, parsing, construction of an AST, some type checking, some simplifications. And likewise, to go from this abstract assembly language to executable, we go through a standard assembler and linker. And then there are also bits and pieces that are kind of heuristics called from the Coq verified part, but their results don't impact the correctness of the generated code, only the efficiency. So those actually don't need to be proved, okay? And we'll see an example with register allocation shortly. And across the years, I've been moving slowly bits and pieces from here to there, so from the unproved part to the proved part. But yeah, that's a lot of work. Okay, so in the end, we get the compiler that runs, and we can even benchmark the quality of the generated code. That's what compiler writers do, right? So this is a small test suite under PowerPC. Shorter is better, it's execution times. Blue, the baseline is GCC without optimizations. Concert is in red. So as you see, it's much more efficient, at least by a factor of two, than unoptimized code of the kind that Airbus is using, for instance. And green is GCC as first level of optimization. So you see Concert is not much slower. And yellow is GCC at higher level of optimizations, which don't make much of a difference on this particular test suite. So in the end, we get about 80 to 90% of the performance of GCC minus 01, which is not bad, given the maturity and quality of GCC. And in the end, we get fewer bugs. That was the intended goal, but so remember this study from University of Utah where they found bugs in all compilers. Well, they also tested Concert and they didn't find bugs in, they didn't find bugs in the code generation and optimization algorithms. And well, they threw about six CPU years to finding a bug. Okay, that's random testing. And so they say that, they say positive things about compiler verification. To be entirely honest, they did find some bugs in this part, okay, which are basically misunderstanding on my side of the C specification. So again, random testing is very useful, even for formally verified things. So now let me maybe peek a little under the hood and show you, or give you an idea on how you go about verifying a pass of compilation. And I will use register allocation as an example. So there are basically two major patterns.
for a given path. When a transformation path, one is to formally verify the transformation algorithm itself. Okay, so this is the implementation of the path, and you prove some semantic preservation property about it. So that's the most straightforward approach. But there's an alternative in the style of translation validation, as introduced by Pnuelli, which is verified translation validation. So here the idea is the transformation is performed by untrusted code, and you're not going to prove anything about it. But at every run of the compiler, every run of this path, you will feed its input and output into, so original and transformed code, into a validator. So that's a piece of code that tries to check semantic equivalence between the two programs. And if it says yes, compilation continues, and if it says no, compilation aborts. Or you just throw away the result of the transformation and you continue with the code before the transformation, in the case of an optimization. The crucial observation here is that it suffices to prove that the validator is sound to get semantic preservation guarantees that are as strong as proving the transformation. What is it, a sound validator? It's a validator that when it says yes, there is actually semantic equivalence between its two inputs. Okay, so in general, that's an undecidable property. So of course, this is just a partial correctness of the validator. So for some compilation passes, you get validators that are much simpler than the transformation itself and easier to prove correct. And for some other passes, actually, validation a posteriori is no easier than just proving the transformation once and for all. And then there are intermediate solutions where, for instance, your transformation can call into some untrusted solver whose results will be checked and by a verified validator, and then whose results will guide the transformation, those kind of things. So again, you can mix and match. And let me illustrate that on an example, which is register allocation. With the classic graph coloring approach, so I don't know how many of you are familiar with that. But basically, register allocation, well, you start with some intermediate code that uses variables, temporaries, in arbitrary number, okay? And then you want to map those variables to processor registers, if you can, because there's only a limited number of them. And those that cannot be put in hardware registers, you will put in memory, in the stack. Okay, but you're really trying to maximize the use of hardware registers because that's what gives fast code. So that's the register allocation problem. The graph coloring approach is basically to reduce the register allocation problem. Well, first to construct a so-called interference graph that summarizes all the constraints about which variables can go into which registers. Basically, there's an edge between two variables if they cannot go in the same register because they are live at the same time. But for instance, between A and B, there are no edges, and that tells us that we can put them in the same register. They can share the same register. And so the problem of register allocation becomes a problem of coloring this graph with colors that are registers or hardware or stack locations if there's not enough colors. So for instance, here is a good coloring. And now you rewrite the code by, the colors are really registers or stack locations. So you substitute every variable by its register. And you may have to insert loads and stores, loads and reloads and spills, So loads and stores to and from the stack when you run out of registers. All right, so that's register allocation by graph coloring in a nutshell. And now, that's a very nice example where you can apply verification or validation or combinations of both. So my first implementation was using an unverified algorithm for graph coloring, the IRC algorithm of Apple and George, which was checked by a checker proved correct in Coq. So it's hard to find a coloring of a graph, but it's very easy to check that the coloring is correct. Right? You just enumerate all the nodes, all the edges, sorry, and you check that the two ends have different colors. In a way, that's the essence of NP completeness. Right? It's hard to find a solution, but easy to check one. So we had colorings that were checked a posteriori, but then everything else, the construction of the interference graph and the code rewriting, was proved correct once and for all. And that was about 2,600 lines of code. Then some colleagues, Sandrine Blasi, Benoît Robillard, and Noah Perle, did a fully verified implementation of the IRC algorithm, and that added about 10,000 lines of proof. So it's a fairly big algorithm. Okay, but then everything is proved, and in particular, so here you can fail at compile time, you can get an error, wrong coloring. Here you cannot, this is proved. And pretty much at the same time, I was working with a student, Sylvain Rideau, and we came up with an approach that is fully based on translation validation. So the whole register allocation problem, including spilling, live-range splitting, etc., so a number of advanced features that were hard to address here and there, is done by untrusted YAML code, and then we do pure translation validation. And that shrinks the amount of proof that need to be done below 1,000 lines, which is cool. And then there are still other approaches that I didn't fully work out, which still cannot fail at compile time, but yet most of the decisions are taken by code that doesn't need to be proved correct. So how do you validate register allocation a posteriori? Well, the idea is to infer and check equations at every program point, equations between the variables of your original code before register allocation, and the locations mentioned in the transformed code after register allocation. So locations are hardware registers, union stack slots. And so what those set of equations means that in every execution of the original code and the transformed code, the current value of this location Li at point P is the same as the value of the variable Xi at point P in the original program. So the most obvious way to go about it is to infer those equations forward. So when we enter the function, we have some equations between the parameters of the function and registers indicated by the calling conventions. And then we go forward by some symbolic interpretation of the two codes. And given a set of equations before those two instructions, we can infer a set of equations after this way. So this is the code before register allocation with some variables. This is the code after with some locations. So we don't interpret the plus, so for those plus to produce the same result, the arguments must be pairwise equal. So we check that we know that x2 equals L2 and x3 equals L3 before. And if that's not the case, we have an error. Then we compute the set after by adding, well, first of all, removing all equations that involve either x1 or L1, because we are going to override those values, and then adding an equation, x1 is equal to L1. Okay, and then you can propagate forward this knowledge. So that's what I proposed, I suggested to Sylvain Rideau, and since he was a very clever student, he came back 3 days later saying, no, this is not the way to do it. Instead of propagating knowledge forward, we should propagate expectations backward, and that would be more efficient. And actually, he was right. So in the backward approach, you're given a set of equations after, and these are equations that must hold after point P for the rest of the function to behave identically up to the next return, okay? So here, basically, it's the post-condition that you have. And now, again, you have those two instructions. So first of all, you need to check that they don't contain equations over x1 and l1 that cannot be satisfied when you assign to x1 and l1. So these are those equations. And then for the equations before, well, you remove the equation x1 equal l1 because you're satisfying it, but you're adding a precondition that says, okay, but it must be the case that l2 equals x2 and l3 equals x3. Okay, and this way, so you can propagate this post-condition upward to the beginning of the function through data flow analysis. And the reason why the backward approach is more efficient is that it generates smaller sets of equations just like when you do liveness analysis, you get smaller sets and reaching definitions. But this is just for compiler experts. And also, I said we don't interpret instructions. We don't try to understand that plus is addition and is associative or whatever. We do interpret move instructions, so copies from a variable to another. And for instance, we can handle so-called coalescing, where you had a copy from a variable to another in the source code, and it's removed in the allocated code because X1 and X2 are in the same place, same register. And so again, you can adjust the equations after to take this into account. And you can also account for moves between locations that were inserted. So typically, spills and reloads when you need to go from a register location to a stack location and back. Okay, so I'm not getting into details, but just to tell you that in the end, so we get a validation algorithm, which is basically a backward data flow analysis. Okay, where you propagate requirements from the return point of the functions all the way to the entry point. And you do some final checks at the entry point, and if all those checks pass, you have a correct register allocation. And so, again, just a glimpse of the way you prove the correctness of such a validator. Basically, you do so-called forward simulation diagrams. So you look at the state of execution of your source program, so at some point P1, environment E1, binding values to variables and memory state. And you assume that you are at the same program point in the transform program with some different environment, E prime one and same memory state, and the two environments, E1, E1 prime, satisfy the set of equations before point P1 that you inferred, okay? And then you consider one transition, one step of execution of your source program that gets you to P2, E2, M2, and you show that you can close this diagram. So the transform program can do one or several transitions, reach point P2, and with an environment that, that satisfies the set of equations before P2. All right. And once you have diagrams like this, you can stitch them together, starting with the initial state, the point where you call the main entry point of your two programs. And so you look at one execution of the source program with some observable events, new one, new two. And so the invariant is initially true, and then you can show that, well, you can stitch together those little diagrams and construct an execution of the transform program that has exactly the same observables, okay? All right, so that's so that was a glimpse of how you go about proving a path of compilation. And now, that will be the last part of my talk. I'd like to talk about the verified compilation of other source languages. So this is mostly speculation and some work done by colleagues. Of course, so why C? Well, C is kind of the lingua franca for systems programming, whether we like it or not. So in terms of usability, it was probably a good idea to start with C. However, the semantics of C is absolutely awful, especially with the pointers, pointer arithmetic, and so on. There are many dark corners. I've been programming in C for 25 years, but I discover new dark corners every 6 months. However, compilation is relatively simple. I mean, this is a language that was designed for compilation. Compilation is not too hard. Optimization is difficult, though, because of all those pointers and so on that are very uncontrolled. And you don't need a runtime system. You can execute C on bare hardware, okay? All you need is a stack for function calls. And that means fewer things to verify. So let's try to move in some other direction. So one obvious direction is C++. So it's all the dark corners of C, plus a fairly rich and complex object model. So that is, I don't know of any, well, there are maybe three or four formal semantics for C, reasonable subset of C. I don't know, maybe one or half formal semantics for C++. Compilation is kind of C-like, but you need a bit of a runtime system, especially if you want to do exceptions, the zero-cost exception. You need a bit of runtime system written in assembly that will unwind the stack frames and so on. And the interaction between that code that needs to be proved correct and the compiler are not obvious. And that problem with runtime systems is even more apparent when you move to high-level garbage-collected languages, typically Java or C-sharp or functional languages like Haskell or OCaml or Scheme. So the good thing about those languages is that they have clean semantics. Okay, well, if you remove some dark corners like reflection in Java, you have some pretty neat and well-defined languages, and that's always a pleasure to work with that. Compilation is non-trivial, but interesting. So, and there might be more opportunities for optimizations because the languages are better controlled, especially through the type system. The big problem is the runtime system, which is pretty large. I mean, you need to do dynamic allocation, you need to do garbage collection, you need to handle exceptions. And so the runtime system is a big chunk of code, some assembly, mostly C, that links with the code generated by the compiler in non-obvious ways. So there's a delicate contract, for instance, in garbage collected languages between the generated code and the GC about communicating the routes to the GC graph and the routes of the memory graph to the GC and keeping that route information accurate. So that complicates the compiler verification, but that also means you have a big chunk of code that the runtime system that needs to be proved using program proof. And logics to do those program proofs, like separation logics, are not exactly what you use to prove the compiler. So there's a lot of interesting but delicate issues here that remains mostly unexplored. And then there are scripting languages, JavaScript being the poster boy, where everything is awful, so the semantics are obscure. Or have colleagues who are almost to the point where they have a full formal semantics for JavaScript in Coq, and they are validating it by testing. The language was not designed for compilation, so compiling it is a challenge in itself. And verifying that compilation is a bigger challenge. And the runtime system is very large. So it's not just a memory allocator on GC. And in the case of JavaScript, you have the whole DOM interface with a browser. And nobody really knows how to specify and reason about that yet. But there is hope for domain-specific languages. So that's really the other end of the spectrum. There's domain-specific languages with limited expressiveness. Typical examples are hardware description languages, synchronous or reactive languages like Simulink, Skate, Lustre, Signal, etc. Database query languages, those kind of little languages that are definitely not Turing complete, okay? And they tend to have very clean semantics just because they are not that expressive. And because they are not Turing complete, they offer unprecedented opportunities for super optimization or even synthesis. Things that would be very hard to do with if you have general loops, for instance. In general, they have no runtime system. Please, that's the case for the hardware description languages, of course, but also for the synchronous and reactive languages. And many of them are used in critical embedded systems. So SCADE and Simulink are very much used in avionics and automotive software, especially of the control command kind. So verification is certainly interesting. And as an example, let me tell you a few words about the verification of a simple language for hardware synthesis, hardware description and synthesis. So that's the work of Thomas Brébon and Adam Schlippler. It's called FESI, Featherweight Synthesis. So it's a simple declarative hardware specification, hardware description language in the style of Lava and BlueSpec, for those of you who know about that. And it's oriented towards the description and proof of parameterized circuits, like an n-bit multiplier for all n, where you want to prove for all n that it computes multiplication. So they use an embedding within Coq. So that's how it looks like to the user. So the user writes Coq functions, generally parameterized by some size information, whose evaluation produces an abstract syntax tree in this little language, FESI, from which Thomas and Adam wrote a simple compiler down to RTL. And they proved the semantic equivalence, semantic preservation for that compiler between the RTL and the FSE. And this cog function can relatively easily be proved correct with respect to a high level spec, like it computes multiplication. And for all n, so typically these are proved by induction. So let me give you a taste of a FSE specification. So do not be afraid. So that's an n-bit KI look-ahead header. So I just want to draw your attention to three things. The first is, since we are embedded into COC, we benefit from some of the features of COC, like dependent types, so very precise type checking. So here it says that this header takes a parameter n, takes two circuits computing integers with 2 to the n bits, and computes a 4 tuple of two booleans, which are the two carries, propagated and generated, and two integers of size 2 to the n bits. So we get precise type checking. Then we get recursion. Okay, so this circuit is built recursively. If n is 0, so you have a 1-bit adder. So that's the base case, where you return propagated carry, generated carry, the sum if there's no carry, and the sum if there's a carry. And the other case is the n plus 1 case, so from so we have two recursive calls that generates adders for 2 to the n bits, and which are then combined to get an adder for 2 times 2 to the n bits, so 2 to the n plus 1 bits. And the last and third thing to notice is that those Boolean expressions or integer expressions you see here are not actually computing with COC Booleans or COC integers when you evaluate this function. Through some overloading and clever notations, these pieces actually construct bits of circuits. So, okay, so this will construct an OR gate, and this will construct some XOR gate, and so on. Okay, and this will construct a multiplexer, and so on. So the evaluation of this function for a given n and some inputs will actually generate a piece of circuit. So the internal representation of FSE, just to give you a glimpse, this is the actual COC definition. So there are two types, one of expressions and one of actions. So expressions are basically combinatorial circuits without memory. Okay, so among expressions, well, you have variables, or wires, if you want, input wires, various operations of booleans, like AND, OR, XOR, etc., various operations on n-bit integers, like addition, and various operations to construct and destruct tuples. And those of you who are familiar with functional programming, you will see that this is dependently typed, so the type of expression is indexed by the type of the result produced by the expression. So you get some pretty good type checking. You can't mix an expression returning a boolean and an expression returning a pair of booleans, for instance. And the actions are sequential circuits. So they include, of course, expressions, so pure combinatorial circuits that you inject into a sequential circuit. There's a connector for where you take an action that produces something of type T, and then through a wire, through a variable of type T, you connect that to another action producing some result of type U. So again, those of you who are familiar with functional programming will recognize a monad here. Then you have registers, that have memories, that you can read and write. And you have guards that give you a little bit of control flow. So a circuit can have one or several Boolean guards that will block the circuit if they are not true. And there's an or else combinator that executes the first circuit if it doesn't block, or the second otherwise. And so, Brebon and Schlipala gave high-level semantics to this simple language, which is close to that of a functional language. And in particular, the only unusual thing for a software person, but very natural for a hardware person, is that the register of writes are batched and performed at the end of the action. Okay, so throughout the execution of an action, the reads always return the same value, which is the initial value of the register. And it's only at the very end of the cycle that the values of registers are updated. And so the semantic of an action is really a state transformer. that, given the state at the beginning of a clock cycle, give you the state at the beginning of the next clock cycle. And using that semantics, you can prove a lot of properties about your high-level circuit. And then the compilation process, well, it's a simple four-stage compiler with a little bit of optimization. So one stage is basically normalization and giving names to intermediate results in expressions and so on, so making sure that all your wires are materialized by name variables. Then there's a transformation of control flow into data flow, which is essentially, this is a part I don't fully understand yet, which is essentially, or in particular, synthesizing write-enable signals for register updates, because it's some registers may be written only if some conditions, some guards are true, okay? So the write-enable signals that are kind of implicit in the high-level semantics are synthesized and made explicit. And then there's a syntactic common sub-expression elimination path that tries to factor out redundant computations, but just looking at the syntax. So this is pretty much what we have in any software compiler. And then comes the synthesis part, which is the BDD-based reduction of Boolean expressions. So really trying to find equivalent sub-circuits and merging them. Okay, so I guess this is pretty naive from a hardware synthesis point of view, but it shows that it can be done, and it can be proved correct relatively easily. So again, this is an actual Coq source code. So this is a FESI compiler, which is a combination of those four passes I mentioned. Note that it cannot fail, and so it takes an action of the high-level language, and it returns a block of the RTL target language. And the correctness theorem says that, well, both languages have a semantics based on next functions, so transition from current to next state. And the theorem is that those two functions are exactly extensionally equal. So the next, for any initial state gamma, the next of your source action A is exactly the next of your RTL generated code for A. All right, so that was an example. And well, let me conclude, and then we'll have time for questions. So coming back to Concert, well, it's not over yet. But at this stage of the experiment, the initial goal appears feasible. The initial goal was to prove correct a non-trivial compiler, possibly usable in the critical software industry. So the goal appears feasible, and even within the limitation of today's proof assistants, such as Coq, many things are more painful than they should be in those proof assistants, and they could be improved in many ways, but nothing was really blocking in this project. And we are moving towards industrialization. So I have a partnership with the Absinthe company in Germany to develop a commercial version of Concert. That can be used in industrial settings. So as I said, there's a lot of things that remains to be done. So investigating other source languages, we've already discussed that. There's, of course, increasing the assurance we get about the compiler, prove or validate a posteriori more of the trusted computing base. So recently, for instance, we did a correctness proof for the parser, which removes some sources of problems. More optimizations. As I said, there are hundreds of optimizations in the literature. And many are interesting from the verification standpoint. What Concert lacks most at the moment is optimizations for loops and matrix code. There are also an interesting question of bootstrap. So remember, we use tools to build Concert. We use a particular Coq extraction facility to generate OCaml and the Camel compiler and runtime system. So there could be bugs in all that, okay? And so we could want to increase confidence in those tools by doing some formal verification over them. A very big issue, or even a can of worm, is shared memory concurrency. So, for instance, C11, the latest revision of the C and C++ standards, standardize some form of shared memory concurrency and weak memory models and so on, but it's awfully complicated. And how to compile that correctly is a bit of a challenge, and how to prove the correctness of such a compilation is a very big challenge. So there's been two major attempts so far, one by Andrew Appel and his group at Princeton that concentrates on race-free source programs. Okay, so basically programs that can be proved correct in a concurrent separation logic. And for that, it seems that it's relatively easy to extend the correctness proofs of and the semantics of COMSERT from the sequential case to the data race-free case. And then another attempt by Peter Sewell and his group at Cambridge, where they tried to handle racy programs, so programs that contain data races. And then you can observe the hardware relaxed memory model, so they formalized only the TSO, total stored ordering. But yeah, these are huge efforts and immensely complex. One point that we were discussing this morning with Victor was connections with hardware verification. It would be very nice to have formal specs for architectures and instruction sets of processors. That would really be a very good link between compiler verification that builds on top of that and hardware verification of the microarchitecture that builds below that. Right now, everyone is kind of reinventing their own formal semantics for the machine code of ARM or x86 or PowerPC or whatever, and then validating by testing. That's not ideal. And finally, remember, we want to do verified compilation because it puts verification tools, source level verification tools, in better light. But of course, those verification tools can also be unsound. They can also have bugs where they say, okay, everything is fine, and actually there is a problem. So some evidence of soundness is good for verification tools, and it's hard to get just by testing. And that leads us naturally to the idea of verifying the soundness of program provers or static analyzers. And so in this direction, with some colleagues from INRIA and Rennes and Verimag in Grenoble and Airbus, we are doing Verasco, which is a static analyzer for C, for COMSERT C, based on abstract interpretation with relational and non-relational domains, and all defined and specified and verified in COC. So we'll have a paper about that at the next Purple conference, and it will soon be on my webpage. All right, so just to conclude, and then we'll move on to questions. Well, I think critical software deserves the most trustworthy tools that computer science can provide. And formal verification of development tools like compilers, code generators, but also verification tools for critical software appears possible. And it also raises some fascinating verification issues. It also improves our understanding of the algorithms involved. Why is it that this classic compiler algorithm works? And I think could have practical impact. So, and if you want more information about COMSERT, I can go to this website. So there's research papers, there's a complete distribution available for evaluation and research purposes. All right, thank you very much.
Any questions? Thanks. So in your section on profit, you spoke about certification. I'm not going to question the profit. And you said that one solution is to limit the optimizations of the compiler. John Rager's commented on the difficulty of debugging optimized code where certain reorderings are transient or they cause side effects. So have you got any comments on whether this, how you could help the author of the software to actually debug code that's been optimized? Is there anything that the COMSERT can provide to them as hints
all right.
on potentially dangerous optimizations?
So compiler verification can help a little bit in that, but not that much. So there's a fundamental tension between optimizing more and making it harder to debug, or just because the relationship with the source code is less and less obvious, or optimizing less and making things easier for the person who debugs. A typical example, if you have a local variable which has a scope, okay, with the debugger, you would expect to be able to see its value at any point in the scope. But actually, the compiler will just remove, forget about the value as soon as it's used for the last time, okay, as when you do classic optimizations. So that's a fundamental tension, and there's nothing we can do about it, I guess. However, what we can do is prove some stuff about the debugger information produced. For instance, prove that if we tell the debugger that at this point register 5 contains the value of source variable X, okay, that's something that we can prove in concert. So, so at least making sure that the info we give to the debugger, even if it's just partial, is actually accurate. So that's the first step.
Okay. I mean, I think generally the worry is that you may believe that you understand what your program does, but some dark corner of C has allowed an optimization which has a transfer fault. I'm thinking of... So in a certification process, you think you've got the right thing, but you've misunderstood your...
Well, my favorite answer to that is that you should verify your C program, okay, with a formal verification tool, and then the undefined behaviors will show up. And then if you use Concert, the compiler will not add new ones. But I understand this is kind of a dream, and John Hager has very good points about that. But yeah, I think he has in mind maybe not super critical software. I mean, those level A, DO 178, programs, for instance, are developed with different methodologies. But anyway, yes, cool.
So, I have a question about completeness.
Yeah.
So you have talked a lot about soundness,
mm-hmm.
But completeness is something that you only briefly mentioned on some slide. So okay. I really liked your slide where you had the 4 different approaches mm-hmm. to the register allocation, mm-hmm. where you have make some different trade-offs. So can you say a little bit more about that? So what
yes,
can you
sure.
say about the completeness of your compiler?
So the formal proof says nothing, and then it's a question of testing. Okay, so you can test the compiler to make sure. Yeah, basically what Kuhn is saying, very politely, is that a compiler that always fails at compile time is formally verified to be correct. Okay. But it's useless, of course. So clearly we need testing to make sure that the compiler doesn't refuse to compile too often, and that the programs we are interested in actually can be compiled. But indeed, we don't try to prove anything about that. So some compilation passes are actually total functions, okay, and it shows up in their type. It's program to program, not program to option program. But indeed, all the passes that involve verified translation validation are partial by definition. Okay, they can always fail at compile time. I think the answer is well more like testing. Even though it's nice when we have a transformation that cannot ever fail.
So why don't you just finish though? I mean, in the sense of where it's too hard, just make a simple transformation, one that you could.
Oh, yes, that's a very good point. So indeed, in this case, when the validator fails, you could fall back on a simpler transformation, or if this is an optimization, so the input and output languages are the same, you could just deactivate the optimization and continue with a copy of the input. So indeed, that's another way to get robustness of the compiler.
Another one. So I was thinking about the profitability aspect of this in the business of hardware synthesis, because mm-hmm. basically you can apply the same methods in hardware synthesis and then save all the equivalent checking business, which is a huge one, right? Because if you have a synthesis tool that can formally guarantee that the synthesized hardware is correct by construction, then we can get rid of all the equivalent checking business now, right?
That is true.
So I was curious to know, how did you go for the software business and not the hardware business?
That's, so indeed. So for hardware, it's doable, at least in principle, to do equivalence checking. I'm not sure it's always doable in terms of checking time and that kind of things when your circuits get very big. While in software, where we kind of gave up on the idea of doing translation validation just from C to assembly, optimized assembly code, the semantic distance is just too big, and we just don't have good algorithms. So for hardware synthesis, an area where I'm definitely not familiar, I think you also have the same trade-offs possible between fully verifying some synthesis passes and once and for all, and using equivalence checking a posteriori for other parts where you don't really want to do a formal proof. So yeah, I think that's certainly very interesting to explore.
So can you say a little bit about the feedback that the programmer gets from the output of COMSort, let's say? So in the case, for example, that certain optimizations failed, does the tool maybe give some feedback to the programmer that says, here is something that is code that I failed to optimize, mm-hmm. even though it might be possible, so if you rewrite this and try it again, maybe I get better code?
No, we don't give any detailed feedback of that kind. So the kind of feedback you get is something went wrong during register allocation. Please report it. I see the kind of feedback you're talking about, and I think it's an interesting question that is kind of orthogonal to whether the compiler is formally verified or not. I don't know of any production compiler that actually gives good feedback of that kind. But yes, that's an interesting direction. Because there are some extremely effective optimizations that apply only if your program is in a certain form. Software pipelining that I showed initially is an example. Many automatic vectorization transformations also only apply to loops that have a certain shape. And I'm not quite sure that automatic vectorizers, for instance, give much useful feedback. That's an interesting.
So I was thinking, since your compiler performs a lot more analyses on the program than just code generating compilers, maybe there's more potential for feedback that the programmer could use. This would have to be an expert programmer, probably, who knows a little bit about yeah. COG, but still.
Okay, yeah, it's an interesting direction for future work.
So I have a question about the first two examples that you showed. There was one where you did loop unfolding, so there is no one-to-one correspondence on the instruction level, right? So it's the equivalence that you have to check is a larger block, right?
That's true.
The second example that you showed, you need essentially floating point semantics, right? You're doing modification of the data type at the byte level, and you need an exact floating point semantics for the...
Absolutely.
So do you do both things? Are both optimizations implemented in your compiler, do them?
So this one is fully proved, and indeed, in COMSort we build an extremely accurate COG specification of floating point arithmetic called FLOC, developed by Guillaume Melchion and Sylvie Boldo, and the description is precise enough that we can prove that this actually computes the integer converted to a double. So concerning software pipelining, it's not implemented in COMSort today, but I had a PhD student, Jean-Baptiste Tristan, who developed a validator a posteriori for software pipelining that I think could handle this example, because here the body of the loop is really simple, there's no conditionals and things like this. So his validator can handle the software pipelining part. Loop unrolling, we don't have verified yet. As usual, this is really the combination of several optimizations that benefit from one another, so that's kind of hard. But just the pure pure software pipelining part, actually we have a validator that works on, simplified languages. I mean, not the full C, but... So it's almost doable.
Any other questions? So perhaps if I would have one regarding the sort of mini blue spec compiler. So if you look at the full blue spec or some other hardware description languages, perhaps we shouldn't quite classify them as small languages in some respect, right?
They all right.
Might be as complicated as C or in some simulation versions.
I would hope that the semantics are cleaner, though.
Okay, so but that's good news, right? So, but
oh, yeah.
It means that this is an interesting agenda also for this community to see whether something of the scale of Comcert could be done for hardware description languages that are widely used in industry, right? And I guess that would be another argument to move the verification to that level, to the source level, as you're pointing out with the C, that you should verify the C source code and not perhaps some other passes. Do you think this is realistic?
Well, I'm not familiar enough with those languages, but I very much hope so. Yes, that that these are maybe bigger languages than I thought, but still have fairly clean semantics, and much could be done. Ah, damn! You're breaking my dreams. Okay. All right. Let's hope it's no worse than C, and that something could be done along the lines of Comcert, but more towards hardware generation. And let me turn that around. I think a crucial step is to get a formal semantics for your source language. Okay, and that needs expertise from ideally the inventors of the language, or at least specialists. And once you have that, I think it opens a lot of opportunities, both for source level verification and for verified transformation and compilations.
So you mentioned also that you model system calls by inserting them into traces.
Mm-hmm.
So do you ever need to reason about what they do?
No, because we just preserve. Those system calls we just axiomatize, and we say, okay, we don't know what they do, but they are going to do the same thing whether they are called from C or from assembly. And so we make sure that we call them at the same times in C and in intergenerated assembly, and with the same arguments. Okay, and so that gives equivalence of observable behaviors.
Any other questions, comments? Then let's thank our speaker.
Well, thank you very much.